One of my fascinations is the series that was made into a movie a few years ago, Master and Commander. Russell Crowe plays this British captain, and he's sailing around the world capturing Frenchmen and various allies of the French in the Napoleonic Wars in a ship that looks a bit like the one on the left. We are in a ship that looks a bit like the one on the right. Now, where do we get this notion of the church as a ship? Well, it goes all the way back to biblical times. This particular ship here is called a trireme. On the end of each one of those oars is three or four rowers. And what you can't see very well is that those oars are in three levels. There's a top row, a middle row, and a bottom row. And those guys are packed in such a way that they literally all lean forward together, they all pull back together, and it's a machine with human cogs, as it were, to make those oars go. Now in Latin, which is where this notion of the church as a ship took hold, the church, or the ship, is called the navis. In fact, you are sitting in what architecturally is known as the navy. So you are all in the navy, my friends. And you are the part of the ship that makes ships of this age go. Well, it's interesting to keep in mind how these ships are laid out. There's just a few guys up front. It's their job to make sure that there's enough water under the keel. They're throwing out a chain of lead. Why did they do that? There's just a few guys in the back. They're the ones who are giving all the orders. And by the way, being a sailing ship, I know it's got oars, but they're also working off with sails. Whenever you have a sailing ship, where's the fresh air? It's not in the bow. It's not like the movie Titanic, where you go to the front of the front in order to feel the wind in your face. Because a steamship can go against the wind. A sailing ship, the wind is from the back. Fresh air is in the stern. That's where the leaders are going to be. And then, like I say, there's literally hundreds of guys in this boat, all downstairs, all pulling oars in a rather exact rhythm. If you get out of rhythm, what happens to you? The whole row in front of you smacks into you. The whole row behind you smacks into you. You have to do it all in a rhythm. Which is why there's one guy up in the front of the ship banging out the rhythm. As long as the oars are going, so is, we've all seen Ben-Hur. Okay. Now, I was talking about a full-rigged ship, also known as a square-rigged ship. What does it need to be one of those? First of all, minimum of three masts, otherwise you have sloops and brigs and stuff like that, but you don't have a square rigged ship. So you got your foremast, your main mast, your mizzen mast. Next, each mast has a yard arm that you hang the sail from. Each yard arm is squared to the mast, and that's where you get the expression a full rigged ship or a square rigged ship. The rigging is often confused with the ropes. But the rigging of a ship is everything that's above the hull. It is the masts, and the masts are that which the rest of the rigging hangs from, but they are part of the rigging. They are the main part of what transfers the power of the wind into the hull, so the hull goes forward. Why is that important? If the hull doesn't go forward, well, you ever go fishing? What happens to your boat as soon as you anchor it? It tends to go beam on to the waves. So the waves go whoosh, and you're doing this. In a storm, you're bad. You want to be able to point into or out of the waves. So having power in a ship is essential unless you're in a very calm place. The masts are the beginnings of the rigging of a ship. Then we add the sails, and the sails are what catches the wind. And the sails catch that wind, and they transfer the power of the wind to the mast, which would all promptly snap off. Even the greatest mast, these old ships, I mean, they had masts like this. They weren't made from a single tree, but several put together, and then with steel bands wrapped around them so that the power of all of them together could be harnessed. The sails are both essential. Without them, you don't have the wind. Without the wind, you don't have forward movement. Without forward movement, the entire ship is in peril in a heavy sea. So the sails are vital. The sails can destroy the ship. The sails pulling on the masts without the stays will cause the ship masts to snap. When they snap, the sails don't work anymore. There's no power transferred to the hull. The hull goes beam onto the waves. The waves roll the ship into the sea. You gotta have the stays. The stays are every one of these ropes. All of these ropes are designed to transfer the power that the sails are pushing into the mast down into the hull of the ship. You see, every rope ties down here. This, to my thinking, is the church. And God has so arranged the body that there may be no dissension. All of these have to work together. But the members may have the same care for one another. And that's ship without masts, doesn't go forward, rolls into the sea. Ship without stays, masts snapped off, rolls forward, goes into the sea. Ship without sails, it sits there, and it's taller, but it still rolls into the sea. You gotta have mast, sails, and stays. Working sails is that glorious picture that we always like to see. That's when all the sails are out, all the rigging is taut, all the masts are full of sail. This is where you truly see the ship that holds sail is the ship that you really see is where one member has to be a part of the whole. If any part of it is undermined, you've got trouble. All working together, you have this magnificent vessel that can cruise through the sea and can even take on tough weather and can really go around the world. And a church can too. If all the members are working together, you can get a church that can go around the world. Storm sails are an interesting feature. Paul tells us in the text today that the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And that's no less true on a ship. You see, these storm sails, they're just little tiny things. They're made out of the heaviest cloth that they can find. And they're almost looped over onto each other. Why are they there? Well, because if the ship doesn't have power to go forward, it'll go beam on and roll into the sea. It's that constant problem. It's the same with the church. The church always needs that forward momentum, that push of the Spirit blowing into our sails. And yet, there are stormy times and there are easy times. When there are stormy times, it's these pathetic little sails that don't make for much of a picture. That's why we have such a lousy picture. We have this magnificent picture of the working sails all out in their glory.
But storm sails, I had that big fire in mind to find the storm sail picture. And it's just these tiny little things. Anything more than that, and the sails would catch too much wind in the storm, and the mast would snap. Stays or no stays, the mast will snap if the sails are catching too much power at a given time. Now, the idea of the ship as a nave, or the navis in Latin, encourages us to think that, well, there's this church, and I'm a passenger. I'm a member. I sail in it. And I would have us rethink that function. I would have us think of ourselves in a different job, but when I do that, the first place I find people go is, oh, okay, I'm not a passenger here. I'm the crew. I help make this thing, go. But I would take us a step further than that. I would say that in a healthy, strong church, the members are the rigging. We are the body of Christ, and individually members of it. We are that mast, this stay, that sail. We are that which catches the Spirit and transfers the power of the Spirit into the hull to move the entire ship forward. Who among us are the masts? If I think this way about the ship and the church, I would say the masts are the leaders. A lot of things hang off of them. But the leaders all by themselves don't make a church. The leaders bear the weight of all the power to transfer that into the hull so that the ship goes forward. But what do we know about masts? We know that masts are just sticks and the wind blows through. Might whistle, might make some sound, it doesn't move a ship. You gotta have sails. You gotta have people that catch the Spirit blowing. You know, when Jesus, Nicodemus talked, Jesus says, you know, you hear the wind and you don't know where it comes from or where it goes to. Well, in Greek, you use the same sentence to say, you feel the wind, you hear it, but you don't know where the wind comes from. The notion in the ancient church that the Spirit is that which blows, God's breath, makes complete sense in that context. The sails, the people who catch the Spirit, are the ones that transfer that energy into the masses, that bring that energy into the leadership of the church. And the connection is made and it all goes forward. Except, that's not the end of the story, is it? Because the power of the world, it's not just God blowing in the sails. The world blows in our sails too. The power of that which blows into the sails will snap the strongest leaders off. The power of the winds will break the masts unless there are people who will tie into the leader and tie into the hull, the church, and transfer the stress on the leader into the hull. If you don't have those rope stays, the masts will snap. The only way to keep the masts from snapping is to not put up any sail. If you don't put up any sail, the boat doesn't go forward. it goes beam onto the waves, and the next time you have high seas, it will roll into the sea. The stays are essential to refocus the stresses on the leaders, the masts, or else you're in great trouble. So masts hold the sails aloft, but no sails, you roll into the sea. If the sails aren't there to fill with the wind, it doesn't matter if you got everything else. Leaders and people to transfer that energy, if you're not catching the spirit, you'll roll into the sea. If the stays don't refocus the power so that the mast won't bear the power of the wind alone, the mast snap off, the ship doesn't go forward, you roll into the sea. This is not an insignificant problem. This isn't something where, oh, we go a few years this way or that way. No sails, no rigging, no masts. You can't do it. Not if you set sail. Not if you go out there into the ocean. You will not last. So, we have to believe that all of us are essential to making it go forward. If we don't, you roll into the sea. We have.
Doesn't get written the week.
stay in the sale? Are you one that feels the Spirit? Do you fill up with that energy? We each have a place here. The rigging is tremendously complex in any of these ships. The people, the congregation, is tremendously complex in any congregation. It's not an insignificant question. Sorting this out is the difference between being a church that sails into the future and being a church that rolls into the sea. I was researching this church's history for the class this afternoon, or next week, next Sunday at 1 in the afternoon. I was intrigued by something I found out. The church that was built in 1874, so the one before the one that this one replaced, built over on 3rd Mary, seated 500. It was built by a church of 40 members. One of the shocks to our leadership in the last month or two is that number that's been sleeping on our rolls is 177. When in fact there have been many changes, and I couldn't even figure out how old that number is, but nobody's bothered to change that record in that part of the UCC system. We in fact have 105 active members. To discover that we are moving this ship through the water so well, with two-thirds of the people we thought we had doing it, less than that in fact, was a stunning blow at first. But then I had to stroke my chin a bit and say, you know, that's a witness to the Spirit. It takes paragraphs to write down all the things that we do here. We're a small body that is doing it, but we're pulling it off today. It speaks very well of us. But when we go from thinking we're 177 to thinking we're 105, the temptation is to say, contract, contract, contract everywhere so that we can manage what's left. This is the church, the congregation, that built the church for 500 down the block. Yeah, I got it right for once. With 40 members. Expect great things. Be the rigging. Sort yourselves out. Know what God is calling you to do. And this ship will move with great grace and power through the seas.